Hi. One or two lectures ago, I distinctly recall mentioning the fossil record. Well, we discuss it in much more detail now. The most direct evidence that evolution has occurred is found in the fossil record. A fossil are the remains of a once living organism. Formerly, only the preserved remains of an organism that lived prior to the end of the last glacial period was called a fossil. I.e., fossils were older than 10,000 years, and remains younger than 10,000 years were called subfossils. That limitation has now been abandoned, and many ancient remains of a living organism can be called a fossil, regardless of its age. The term includes skeletons, tracts, impressions, trails, borings, and casts. Fossils are usually found in consolidated rocks. But not always. For example, woolly mammoths living 20,000 years ago were recovered from the frozen tundra of Siberia. It is unusual for organisms to be preserved complete and unaltered, generally. The soft parts decay and the hard parts undergo various degrees of change. Solution and other chemical actions may reduce the tissues to a very thin film of carbon. This process is called carbonization. The organisms may be flattened by the compaction of sediments to form compressions. Porous structures, e.g. bones and shells, may be made denser by the deposition of mineral matter by groundwater. This process is called permineralization or petrifaction. The internal physical structures of some shells may be changed as a result of solution and reprecipitation. In this process, recrystallization, the original structure may be blurred or lost. Many shells, which were originally composed of aragonite, are recrystallized into the more stable mineral calcite. The solution of an original shell and the simultaneous deposition of another mineral material constitutes replacement. This may occur molecule by molecule, in which case the microstructure is preserved en masse where it is not. Common replacement minerals include silica, iron sulfide, but there are many others. The impression of skeletal remains is surrounding sediments constitute a mold. Where the external structures are preserved, it is called an external mold, and where the internal structures are preserved, it's called an internal mold or Steinkern. Filling of a mold cavity by a mineral matter may produce a natural cast. Tracks, trails, burrows, and other evidence. Organic activity may also be preserved. These are called ichnofossils or trace fossils. Geologists can determine the absolute age of rocks using isotopic dating. At the time a rock forms, some elements exist as different isotopes. Over time, the less stable isotope is converted into the other isotope, and the ratio of the two forms changes. By dating the rocks in which fossils occur, we can get an accurate idea of how old the fossils are. When fossils are arranged according to their age, from oldest to youngest, they often provide evidence of successive evolutionary change. At the largest scale, the fossil record documents the course of life through time, from the origin, the first prokaryote, and then eukaryotic organisms, through the evolution of fishes, the rise of land-dwelling organisms, the reign of the dinosaurs, and on to the origin of humans. In addition, the fossil record shows the waxing and waning of biological diversity through time, such as the periodic mass extinctions that have reduced the number of living species. The most famous intermediate form has to be Archaeopteryx, which lived in the late Jurassic around 165 million years ago. This specimen is clearly intermediate between some non-avian theropods and modern birds. It has many characteristics in common with Maniraptoran theropods, for example, possession of teeth, a slightly enlarged brain case, a long and well-developed tail, no carpo metacarpus, no tarso metatarsus, and no syncrasacrum. Nonetheless, it has pneumatic bones and partial flight adaptations. The first Archaeopteryx fossil was discovered in 1859, the year Darwin published On the Origin of Species. Since then, paleontologists have continued to fill the gaps in the fossil record. Today, the fossil record is far more complete. Fossils have been found linking all the major groups. The recent discoveries of Ambulocetus, Rodhocetus, and Pachycetus have filled in the gaps between cetaceans and their artiodactyl ancestors. The features of Pachycetus illustrate that intermediate forms are not intermediate in all characteristics. Rather, some traits evolve before others. In the case of the evolution of cetaceans, changes occurred in the skull prior to evolutionary modifications of the limbs. All three fossil forms occurred in the Eocene period, approximately 45-55 million years ago. Tiktaalik is another fine example of a species that bridged the gap, this time between fish and amphibians. Horses, zebras, donkeys, and asses, all classified in the same genus, Equus, are the last living descendants of a long lineage that has produced 35 genera since its origin in the Eocene period, approximately 55 million years ago. Hyracotherium, the earliest known genus of the horse family, did not look much like Equus at all. With short legs, broad feet, these species occurred in wooded habitats, where they probably browsed on leaves and herbs and escaped predators by dodging through openings in forest vegetation. The evolutionary path from these small animals to the workhorses of today has involved changes in a variety of traits, including size, toe reduction. Modern equids can weigh more than 500 kilograms. Examination of the fossil record reveals that horses changed little in size for their first 30 million years, but since then, several different lineages have exhibited rapid and substantial increases. The feet of modern horses have a single toe. Hyracotherium, by contrast, had four toes on its front feet and three on its hind feet. Examination of fossils clearly shows the transition through time. A general increase in length of the central toe and reduction and loss of the other toes. These horse lineages were also evolving change in the length and skeletal structures of their hind limbs, leading to animals capable of running long distances at high speeds. Evolutionary change has been far from constant and uniform through time, as fossils demonstrate. Rates of evolution have varied widely, with long periods of little observable change and some periods of great change. Moreover, when changes happen, they often occur simultaneously in different lineages of the horse evolutionary tree. Fossils form when an organism is preserved in a matrix, such as amber, permafrost, or rock. They can be used to construct a record of evolutionary transitions over long periods of time, which allows us to understand how major changes in evolution occur. The extensive fossil record for horses provides a detailed view of evolutionary and diversification of this group. Although trends are not constant and uniform and may include exceptions. Thank you very much. I hope you've thoroughly enjoyed this lecture on fossils and the fossil record. And it's given you more of an insight into biology and evolution. Thank you.